feel good! Michelangelo Badio here. Before we start the festivities tonight, I want to just say, do a few shout-outs to Denny. I see Cynthia. Let's see, Doug. Who else? Brett, Nick, Roxana, Jenny, and then there's John. Roxana's there. I see somebody named Mike. Hey, Mike. And then Joey's here. Hello. How are y'all doing? Now, hey, Nick, how are you? It's good to see you. Denny, how are you? And, you know, before we get too far into this, I just want to thank everybody for the tremendous support that I have received. This has been a year like no other in my music career, and I've been very grateful to have, you know, this incredibly long, successful career, but to be able to headline sold-out arenas consistently. Manowar just played in Switzerland. Megadeth headlined one night. Manowar headlined one of the other nights. We drew a record attendance. You could not move. And these are outdoor venues, you know. An average show for Manowar is, you know, 12,000 to 17,000 people. And it's just incredible. And, you know, I can't say enough. And so to thank everyone, you know, for the support behind this, because I never take any of this for granted. Now, one of the things I wanted to talk about, and is a lot of people have asked me about Speed Kills, because I don't know what's happened with it, but it's just continued to be in the scheme of things with guitar instructional programs and tuition. And, you know, people have asked me, you know, like, what goes into making that? You know, how did you come up with, I'll give you the keys to the Lamborghini and all this stuff. But really, what was, you know, the idea behind all this? Now, let me... One thing I can tell you is this, that, you know, it's easy for someone to give lessons and say, okay, well, I think you should do this, 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 and this. When I studied picking, and I made the science of it, and now today, you know, myself and then people like Troy Grady have really gone incredibly in depth, almost to the, you know, microscopic level about analyzing how I pick and other famous guitars. One of the things that I really had to understand, I didn't know what was important and what wasn't important when you learn guitar, because there's a million questions, you know, and that's one of the things where a beginning player or even an intermediate, you're on the quest, you're like, well, what do I need to do? What should I work on? And so one of the hardest questions for me to answer was, what was important? What is important in playing guitar? What should you focus on? What shouldn't you focus on? And so what I really made a study of is I looked at famous players. Now, you know, people would say, well, why don't you look at this, this, and this? But I figured I only want to see the people who are in the game, in the big league game, because they've gone through the wars, they've gone through the battles, and they've survived and thrived, and I want to see how they do it. And it's like today, you know, anybody can put on an instructional program, but my first question would be, what have you done? Like, what gives you this knowledge that you can impart to everybody else as the gospel or whatever? You know, it's not religious, of course. But so here's what I did. When I did my first instructional video, it was called the Starlux video. It's the first shred video ever. In fact, the very first time... The first time the A minor shape was ever shown on an instructional program was mine. I didn't invent it. I'm not saying I invented it and didn't create sweep technique. I did not. I just showed it because everything was so new back then. But when I did the Starlux video, everything, let's see, my inspiration. Oh, sorry. I don't want to get sidetracked with questions yet. I want to just complete these thoughts. But when I did my first instructional video, I was told to make some exercises, which I did. And people call the Paul Gilbert riff. Oh, Jerry didn't like that one. No, no, no. It wasn't the Paul Gilbert riff. I did it. I, me, Joe, eat. And so what happened was, it's funny, but this. It was on my Starlix video as one of the exercises, and it became known as Paul Gilbert's riff, and I love Paul, so it helps you. And then the gargoyle riff. That was on my video too. How the heck did he get those names for it? I'm like, why don't you just call it the Badio riff or the Angelo riff? No, it's got to be Paul Gilbert's gargoyle riff. And, you know, did it upset me at first? Yes. Why? Because my competitive edge. But the other side of me says, look it. It's there to help people. Helping people can't be a bad thing. So, you know, I'm good with it. And so what I'm alluding to with all this is that in my first instructional program, it was called Star Licks. They did 20 licks, couple exercises. And so I did all the exercises clean and blistering fast. And then I did their licks. But they, and I was kind of guided to do really long exercises. So, you know, riff one. We're going to give you the Ginsu knives, dude. And so it's like these riffs went on and on and on. And that was contrary to the way I learned classical piano and the way that the methodologies of when I went to the university and studied music and studied proper techniques. And again, look, at music has no rules. But music theory was an attempt to describe why Johann Sebastian, why people like Bach sounded so good. And music is numbers, which is why it translates so well to computers. So anyway, after doing that, here's riff number two. Now here's it slow. I mean, it was like, what is going on here? And so when I got a chance to do speed kills, what I said, somebody wrote, would you recommend learning on the acoustic before plugging in? No, I think you can do both. I mean, I'm an electric guitarist that plays acoustic guitar, which is, I'm doing a blistering rendition of Freight Train, the Nitro classic Freight Train. We just finished filming it and playing it. It is, and the BPM is right up there with the original, but it's all on acoustic, an octave lower. I love playing acoustic. They're totally unrelated. It's almost like if somebody said, well, what's acoustic guitar versus electric? Now, this is a pretty far stretch, but it's almost like this. It's like driving a motorcycle or a small car. They're just so different. Acoustic is not granted, the frets are the same, the strings, but the feel of it, the what you do with it, it's so vastly different. It's the same instrument, but they are very, very different. So I would say playing acoustic helps my electric guitar playing, definitely, because it strengthened my fingers. But I think that, you know, I played both when I was growing up because I loved the sound of both, and they're so different. Now, getting back to the making of speed kills, can you play I Want It from Holland? Okay, so I'm going to do this for somebody. I didn't write this one. It's called I Want It, but I wrote this. Anyway, that's the I Want It riff. I see probably the greatest singer ever is here, Jim Gillette. He wrote KOG, King of Guitar. Thanks, Jim. Jim is the ultraviolet. He's got more titles in mixed martial arts than you can possibly imagine. And, you know, as a special select black belt, it's really great. We've been like family forever. My mom and dad always looked at Jim like it was like one of their second son. So thanks, Jim, for coming on. Getting back to the speed kills, here's what happened. I was in Nitro. Jim did his vocal course, Vocal Power, which was amazing through Metal Method. And I was out of my contract with Starlix. You know, I had a 5-year contract, so it was a long time between the first and the second program. But when I did Speed Kills, I did it in the way that I was taught to learn how to play. Because, see, in orchestral music, they didn't have the, well, they had pundits like we have today. Oh, speed sucks, dude. It really was something from late 20th century critics of rock music where they just went so overboard. Like, you know, like Rolling Stone and these magazines, you know, that'll put the top 100 guitar players, but never in a million years would they put Alan Holdsworth or you know, even an Yngwie Malmsteen. You know, it's the Santanas, the Eric Claptons, which, granted, they belong up at the top, but there are other people that changed this this landscape of music, too, on guitar. And so what I did with Speed Kills is, first of all, Jim and I were living at Gold's Gym. I mean, I was in the best shape of my entire life. Now that COVID's over, I've been going back to the gym a lot and, you know, really getting my, you know, I've been touring all year. And so, and it's very easy for me to tour. And I did 20 shows, 20 days in 10 different countries earlier this year. And it wasn't a big problem because, you know, I just got my athletic health together again. And, you know, it's hard to look like I did when I was 30, but, you know, the feeling is still there. And so, anyway, with Speed Kills, it wasn't about these long exercises. It was about short exercises. That's how I learned on piano. Short exercises specifically based on one technique. Or you could combine them if that's what the exercise was about, but you focus on the technique. And I've said this before, musical people just find a way to make music. So you've got these people who've seen a million times online where somebody's playing like one solo. Just incredibly tasteful or something, or, you know, and you're like, how the heck are they pulling that off? Or, you know, they've got two fingers like Django Reinhardt. But Django Reinhardt, again, was a perfect example. He had two working fingers. These other two were paralyzed. I think he got into a fire. Something happened. But anyways, fingers look like this. And he was kind of the one that, you know, instead of going, you know, like a chromatic, he would go like, and it sounded the same. And so I've been playing chromatic scales like that, but, and so I was just thinking of Django for a second, but because I saw a gypsy jazz show just recently at Billy Corgan's club in Illinois in Highland Park. Beautiful place. It was a great Italian guitar player with the trio. So I was thinking about that when I was playing. But anyway, the point is that music, when someone's musical, they find a way to make music on whatever instrument they want to use to make that music. You know, like Robert Fripp said this about Jimi Hendrix. Robert Fripp, the guitarist from King Crimson. He said Jimi Hendrix had something to say, and it just so happened that the guitar was the way he said it. And I truly believe that. I got to tour with, Kathy online. Hello. I see Matthew, John, hey. And and the point is that Hendrix just played. When I got to go on tour with Noel Redding, his original bass player, I asked him how it was like. How did it feel to play on these major songs like All Along the Watchtower and all this stuff? And he goes, I don't know, mate. I go, what do you mean? He goes, I didn't play on it. And he had a nickname for Jimi Hendrix. I have to get his book. He's one of the few guys I have an autograph from. The autograph is right here. I'm going to show you guys this. You got to check this out. Okay. I don't even know if you're going to be able to see it. Hold on a second. Now, I am pulling this off my wall. Okay, can you zoom in on this, Adam? Is it easy to see? Can you guys see this? Okay, that is Noel Redding's autograph right here. This is Noel Redding, what he looked like when I jammed with him. This is in 1999, and he passed away a little bit later. Here's Noel, and that's his card. Now, I never did this with anybody. I'm hanging out with Eddie Van Halen. I couldn't go, Eddie, can I please have you autograph? I love you. I couldn't do that. But anyway, so here's Noel. Let's move the camera down a little bit. Yeah, so there's Noel there. There's his autograph. And that's him when we were jamming. So I got to play Purple Haze with the man who played Purple Haze. And it's very interesting. I'm going to set this down for a second. I'm going to tell you what he told me. And I wish that I could remember exactly what he had. He wrote a diary. And I'm going to just set the stage. This is 1999 in the wintertime. Okay, so the millennium was coming up. I was doing workshops. We toured all over the Netherlands. And now pot is legal there. Now, I'm totally straight. And so I don't smoke pot. I don't do drugs. I drink occasionally. That's about it. And even on the first Nitro album, OFR, it says drugs are for dumb blank. Don't be a dumb blank. Someone asked if I have memories of Awesome John. Of course, Awesome was my friend, Istanbul. And he was great. I really felt bad when he passed away. I love playing in Istanbul. Manowar did a massive show there June 4th. It was fantastic. But anyway, getting back to Noel. So I'm sitting in a 500-year-old hotel in Amsterdam, and Noel pulls out this bag of, like, Thai weed. Now, I knew a little bit about this stuff, but, I couldn't smoke pot. I tried it, of course, I'm not going to lie, but it warped my brain. I always wanted to stand on the rooftop. I would listen to a sound and go, like the most awesome sound. And so, but anyway, I'm sitting at this hotel, it's 500 years old, with Noel, and I start saying, we start talking about Hendrix and all that. See, if anybody knows the history, Noel was actually a guitar player. He was in a band called Fat Mattress, too. And I know a lot about Hendrix because I loved him. Anyway, we're talking, and I said, what is it like playing on these songs, like all along the Watchtower and all this? And he goes, I don't know, mate. I go, what do you mean? He goes, I didn't play on him. And I said, what are you talking about? And then he had a nickname for Hendrix. I cannot remember it, but he wrote a diary, and he wrote a book, which I never got. He was supposed to send me one, but he passed away shortly after, in the early 2000s. So we wanted to do a tour together here. I mean, we hit it off really good. His compliment to me was, I was okay for an American. I'm like, is that good? Yes. I'm like, okay. And so, but he didn't like the United States. He was kind of a bitter guy at the time, but because he received no money from the Hendrix estate. And I don't know if he was entitled. I mean, I'm not an attorney. So, that argument or subject, I don't really, know, or, could, so I can't discuss it. But here's what I did know, and this is what I'm saying, where Speed Kills comes into play. Noel told me he didn't feel bad with what happened with All on the Watchtower. Noel actually did play bass on that song, but he said Jimmy had a nickname for Noel, not the other way around. Noel didn't have the nickname for Hendrix. Hendrix had the nickname for Noel. And Noel said that he called him like buddy or whatever it was. It was something really cool, and I'd have to get his book to find out. And he said that check this out. He was like a little kid. He wanted Noel to hear what he did. And Noel understood something, that Jimmy had something to say, and he had to say it a certain way. The bass had to be the way he heard it in his head. That's the way his music was. And that's what I'm talking about. Musical people just find a way to make music. And Noel told me that he didn't really take it personally, that he could completely understand. It wasn't that he didn't like Noel's bass playing. The vision that he had in his head for how the music was supposed to be could only be done on bass the way he heard it. And I get that. I think anybody can get that. And so where do speed kills come into play? I am not a judge. I'm not a jury. I'm not an executioner. I'm not one that I'm not a politician. I'm not a religious, you know, person to dictate to you. So what I am is a teacher. And my job as a teacher of guitar was not to influence what you learn, what you play, yes, what you learn, but not what you play or what you like. So what I did is I said that this is the technique. This is how I learned it in orchestral music, short riffs. Adam, do you see on the DAW system there, do you see where it says 220? Just put on the drums at 220 now. I'm just gonna kick it up to this. Do you see where it says? Okay, now watch. Now this okay, that's it. Now, I'm just goofing around playing 16th notes at 220. And I was using economy picking, then I used some legato. Try it again, ready? Is nothing. 16th notes at 220 is really freaking fast. And so the point is, what I did is I showed technique, because a musical person with more guns and more ammo can do more things. Now, maybe that's not the greatest analogy, but the point is simply this, that I showed the techniques in short exercises. One of my biggest things now, oh, Denny asked any advice on hybrid picking. One of my instructional programs, you know, I show like. That's hybrid picking. So you use a. So you use your fingers. And you also use a pick. So it's hybrid between picking and your fingers. The advice is, there's a lot of good exercises. Like I showed some really simple ones too to start with. Like, you know, stuff like that. And so hybrid picking is, again, it's a learned skill like anything else. I have specific exercises. I think it's Speed Kills 3 that I really focus on hybrid picking because, but here's what I did on every exercise. I focused on a short exercise that was specifically designed to make you better on this, whatever technique I was teaching. And the cool thing about, for example, alternate picking. Now I can do economy picking. Then when you combine it, you know, it's like you can do pretty much anything, but I isolated each exercise. And one of the cool things about Speed Kills is that I was, you know, Jim and I were in Nitro, and, you know, we were at the top of our game, and our first album, OFR, had done, you know, incredibly well. And, you know, we had money from the record company. They upped our budget, you know, 4 or 5 times. And, you know, we were going to the gym, Gold's Gym. You know, when you see me in the Gold's Gym t-shirt, you know, and I'm 6 feet tall, almost exactly, and so 181, 182 centimeters, and I weighed 142 pounds. that is really thin compared to today. And but, you know, so people said, but see, I was ripped. Like, if you take it back to that era, I looked really ripped in person. And Jim was like, you know, Chippendales dancer. I mean, he was just chiseled. And they still chisel today. And you know, we trained hard, but we, you know, speed kills, the reason it's been so incredibly successful, in my humble opinion, is that I used my university degree and what I learned about history. I love history because my dad used to say, son, don't reinvent the wheel. And it was a big phrase for me, because when people don't know what happened before them, they're going to make the same mistakes of the past. But if you remember that there was a 21-year-old guitar player in the 1930s named Charlie Christian. One of the, you know, he's considered the first electric guitarist. There was a 21-year-old guitar player in a fairly big band called the Beatles. And so you, there's people throughout history that were young at that time there, and they were the cutting edge of their era. And it's good to know about that. That's what I love about music. You can understand what Bach went through as a composer, because a lot of it's written down. The music is notated. So the notation of that era is the same as recordings of today. How could you ever notate Jimi Hendrix going? And the wah. How could you notate when Paul McCartney goes, when you told me, you know, an old darling, when he's just screaming at the top of his lungs? Or how do you notate Joe Elliott going, what do you want? I won't. How do you write I won't? How do you write that on paper? I want you to sing it like this, not I won't rock and roll. They want I won't rock and roll. Well, how do you write that? How do you write Elvis going, you ain't nothing but a hound dog? How does someone write that? You can't. And see, so in the old days, notation was everything. The notation told us exactly how it was played. That's why, even without recordings, we have a really, really accurate and good idea of what happened musically. We don't have that today. If we didn't have the recordings, Led Zeppelin, how are you going to write in music? And as we wind on down the road. So anyway, but, you know, you can do that. You know, I can write that solo out, but I can't say the amp sound. You know, if you've never heard it before and you had no idea how Jimmy Page played it, you just would have no concept of really what the composer was trying to articulate in his music. And so, again, here's where Speed Kills comes in. It's one of the first and only programs of its time to actually show you on electric guitar different techniques the way a classical pianist would have learned how to play technique. Because, see, in orchestral times, there's three different ways you can approach things. One, you play music, a song, with any technique you want. That's a musical person. Two, you play very technically. And three, you combine both and you're this massive virtuoso like a Mozart or a Rachmaninoff. And so what I learned is that there were pieces like Bach's 2 and 3 part inventions, Sinfonios, the well-tempered clavier, that were musical pieces, but especially the inventions, they were designed to help students. So they were musical pieces to show technique and play a piece of music, which is why I wrote No Boundaries. It was that whole idea of the inventions. And so to give you a piece of music to study, but that you just didn't study an exercise, you studied the exercises within a context of a piece of music. So that's why that's on there. But the other way was you broke it down and you worked on specific things to be faster. Short exercise, do-do-do-do-do-do, do-do-do-do-do-do. Then you incorporated that, the better you got at those exercises, a musical person will use what they've got. So if you have better technique, look at Dream Theater. Tommy Jordan Rudess doesn't use his technique to write, or John Petrucci or Yngwie Malmsteen. I mean, come on. They can play what they play so they can write what they play. It's pretty simple. And so, but if you can't play that and you're Kurt Cobain, then you go fall into that class of you're just a musically gifted person and you find a way to do it. And so it's a different type of musicality. My job was just to show the technique. And the thing on Speed Kills that I loved is that was a moment in time that was captured. I'll give you the keys to the Lamborghini was just said off the cuff. You know, Doug Marks and I were goofing around, and I just said it, and Doug had a great, you know, he filmed it. I mean, it was that quick. It wasn't like we planned that in the video. That had nothing to do with it. I just happened to say, you know, we were goofing around. I'm going to give you the keys to the Lamborghini. And it came out. There's so much playing in Speed Kills because I work super hard. I practice and I practice and I practice and I practice and I practice some more. I worked on that. I was playing 10, 12, 13, 14 hours a day, and we were training. And so, you know, when you say, you know, what about filming? The making and filming, it was a lot going on mentally, but you still have to deliver. It was analog tape. It was analog source. So we had a three-camera shoot. So we had three cameras going. We had to do linear editing. So that camera went to another piece of tape where we chose which camera angles would go where during the instructional program, and it was all done for real. So I was well rehearsed, and Doug just had a great setup, that blue sound stage. It was in Chatsworth. I can't remember exactly where the studio was at the time, but it was just incredible time, but the methodology was sound, and that's why Speed Kills, well, 20 years from now, people will look at it and say, yeah, man, you know, it's cool. Now, granted, there's a million other techniques out there. And look, I love anybody who's teaching guitar. I want to help you. And I think anybody that teaches, it's a noble thing to pass on information. And I freely do it. I've showed you everything that I know. And it's helped me be better, too, because I'm sure not going to lie to you. Because look at where I'm at my age. I use what I say. And so I practice those exercises from Speed Kills, and I use that to create music. And so, again, it follows the same thing that it's done for centuries. The better you are at the technique, you find a way of being a musical person to incorporate it into your music. You can separate the two. There's music, there's technique, there's the merging of both. And so the greatest players have a full knowledge of the technique, whether they know every little detail in music theory like I do because of my degree or not, it doesn't matter. But they have the various techniques down, and they're musical, and it merges together. So that's it. Now, I didn't talk a lot about the Sawtooth Sail because I love Sawtooth. I can tell you this. They have a 60% off sale, and Sawtooth is, they've got a lot of left-handed guitars. This is my first signature guitar. This one and the black matted finish. It's the STM24s. And this is actually the prototype of it. I just keep this one and the black one in my studio all the time. They're really great. Sawtooth is a fantastic company. I love working with the people. They're amazing. They produce great guitars. And they've given you a choice to get the best guitar you can get with the best features for the best price and the value of it. And I can't say enough about it. So they've got the 60% off sale. I know that in the comments, you're going to see, you know, links to go. But if there was any time to buy a guitar, it is now. It's one of the best times to buy a new guitar. And, you know, because the prices are great, it's before the last quarter of the year, but the summer sale is going to be it's over pretty soon. So, getting back to all this stuff. Yes, yeah, somebody wrote Long Way From Home. You might mean Long Way From Home, which is another Nitro song. We're going to do, we're actually, like I said, You know, the band, you know, we were calling it the MAB band, but it's really just Michelangelo Badio and Joe Fuoco's on drums, and we have Nils Lawrence on bass, great singer. We're doing an acoustic version of Freight Train that's absolutely mind-blowing. I put a couple snippets online and it blew up. And then we're going to do a Nitro song, a second one called Long Way From Home. And we do a preface in there because our bass player, the bass player in the band, Nils, is a huge Nitro fan, and he's got a great voice, but he acknowledges right away there's no way he can sing like Jim Gillette. He doesn't have that range, the power, but he's still a really good singer. So what we did is we figured, and he's been bugging me for like a year, Mike, let's do Long Way From Home. You know, it's one of his favorite songs, and we're going to do a version of that. And before we actually release the song, where we're doing I filmed a little video to talk about, you know, how Nils felt about singing Jim's parts. And, you know, we just adjusted it for his range. Jim was in the soprano stratosphere, full voice. And you know, not everybody can do that. Even a lot of women, singers that are sopranos can't sing, you know, that high and that clear. But anyway, let's see. Yeah, somebody said, is that a sawtooth telly with humbuckers? Yes. So let me... this is one of the ones, we want your opinion on this. This is a model that Joey B, the main tech for setting up all the guitars. Sounds great. Just got a killer sound. Talking about other guitars here. I always crack up. You know, it's like, I'm going to just say something. It's because it's kind of funny. This guy's Sussy or Niao, I don't know. But anyway, they're online talking. Now, I have toured in 60 countries. I have been an ambassador for the companies that I represent for 30 years. Now, if you walk in to a Coca-Cola plant, the last thing they want to hear is about Pepsi. Okay, so now call me crazy, call common sense, but you guys do this stuff. You know, if you should kind of think about things before, you know, think before you ink. And the reason I'm saying that is it's one of the things when I used to read, like especially in the internet's early days, everybody had an opinion, and you know, it was some of it was, I actually couldn't believe how toxic some of the comments and things, not about me. I mean, yeah, you know, every famous person gets stuff, you know, said about them. You know, that's whatever. I can only control my pages. I can't control anything else. We don't control our pages because that's like coming into my house. Don't come into my house with dirty feet and walk on my carpeting. And it's insulting to me and it's disrespectful. And I feel the same way when people come to my page and they start rambling on BS about something that's completely unrelated to what I'm doing or what I'm talking about, and you know why. You know, but I can say as a person that has been in all different types of scenarios and met pretty much every person that kind of lives on this planet, you know, type of person, and you know, from the Aboriginals in Australia to the jungles of the Philippines, I've been there. But you know, one of the things that you can do is know your surroundings. Look around you. be vigilant. Okay, and you know, I mean, knock on wood, I just try to be like that. Like Manowar has security people, so we're not allowed to go out sightseeing, you know, unless we're accompanied by somebody. It's not like we're afraid to be attacked or anything, but it's just, it's courtesy to the other people and to the audience and the people that are buying tickets to the shows. But, you know, it's courtesy. And it's courtesy and respect. And, you know, if I think truly, if people would be more courteous online, the toxicity of online has filtered into the real world. Well, what if we start being nicer online and actually thinking more? I think that would go a long way to being, you know, coming back too in the real world. And so, but, you know, I don't like to see it. And there's another reason. I'm seriously trying to help. You know, I'm trying to help you, and I'm trying to say, look, here's the benefit of my experience, and this is how you can be better on guitar. And, you know, I can't, you know, it's the old saying, you can't bring a horse to water and force it to drink. You can bring it to water, but you can't, you know, it's the horse got to drink. It's like when people say to me, dude, I never got the keys to the Lamborghini, dude. I've got that. I've heard that a million times. I had to come up with a response. It took me a few decades, but I did. And so I figured I need a good response to that. And my response is simply this. I gave you the keys. I told you I was going to give you the keys to the Lamborghini. I did. But it's up to you to drive the car. I can't drive it for you. And so and that's the whole method to the madness here. The making and filming of Speed Kills was designed for one thing, to help guitar players, to help you. Doug Marks did it fantastically. I had Jim Gillette. You know, we were you know, partners. We're super close now. You know, we had my tech dragon in on it. He chimes in, DRAG and then N. You know, we just, it was a collaborative effort by a lot of people, but the whole goal was to help you. And I did it the best that I could. And I did it with the most information that was available to me. Which is my background in music, and I majored in music theory in high school, and I have a degree in it in college at the university. So I used that, and I used what I knew about how to teach based on what other teachers had taught for centuries, and I used that methodology to bring it into the modern era. Anyway, let's see. When you get loud... Oh, man. Oh, somebody said they had to put their dog down, and he liked it when I started yelling. That wasn't me. It was Joey. It was me. I love dogs. And are the original videos available again? Not in video form, but if you go to metalmethod.com, the original Speed Kills program is available.
In the description.
What? Yeah, and it's in the description where you can go there. And so just like on the Sawtooth 60% sale, The description on the comments is where you can find the links and the description of the program, you know, the video that we're doing today, the live stream, you can find Metal Method. Yeah, the original programs are there. We're really proud of them. And Jim came up with the idea of, instead of writing exercise, we wrote X, R, size. And so you see that too. And it's just, I love doing it because I'm still great friends with Doug Marks. We're still real close. I'm still great friends with Jim. We're like brothers. And Jim is super successful in anything he's ever done, whether it's music, martial arts, his business. You know, Jim's he's just an amazing, amazing person and friend. And he's a powerhouse. You don't want to, he's one guy I would never bet against, and I'm not just saying that. He will win. He will find a way, and he does it. You know, we're very positive people. But you know, he did his vocal power for the same reason I did Speak Hills, to help. And so I get bummed out sometimes. That's what I was saying. You know, when I read some, like when people, if they say weird comments or something, I don't care if people criticize me on other pages. Who cares? You never see me write. When I'm trying to help, and if you don't listen, it doesn't say about me. It says about you. You know, I'm here to help. I'm not bragging about something. I'm just saying these are the exercises. This is how he did it. And so, you know, I generally care, which is why I do. Anyway, getting back to this guitar, it's really, really gorgeous. These are like, you know, you can see on the pickup holders here, they're just this beautiful ornate design, all black. It's got a top of the line Floyd Rose system, which is and it was made for me. And so, but if you're interested in this, Sawtooth might do a limited run of this and a couple other of the models. But anyway, I can't say enough about Sawtooth guitars. They rule. You're going to be seeing some really incredible videos coming out. They make a great line of acoustics. They were one of the only companies that did a full line of left-handed guitars that were the exact mirror image of their right-handed. So many models. Took a lot of companies a long time to pick up on that one. You're seeing more and more now, but we've been doing it for 10 years. And, you know, it's just a lot of things that we're doing here are really innovative as far as giving you the best features and the best value for your money. So anyway, I want to thank each and every one of you. You're going to see me if you live in Central or South America. I'm going to be on tour. If you were in Switzerland last week and you saw this massive, gigantic, huge show that Manowar was, thank you for that Manowar did. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for the incredible support. I never take any of this for granted. Anyway, see ya. I'm Joey. Robert does not talk. I'm Michelangelo Badio.